Hello everyone, my name is Inga and I'm pleased to welcome you to the webinar Introduction to Unified Architecture Framework, UAF. UAF provides an infrastructure to ensure complete and correct specification of system integration using various techniques, such as engineering analysis, traceability, and metrics. Some of these techniques are covered in this webinar, which also demonstrates the complete workflow of systems engineering using UAF framework. The session is hosted by Edita Milavichina. Edita is the Cameo Enterprise Architecture Product Manager at Nomagic. She has been with Nomagic for 15 years and her expertise is software and systems engineering, model-based enterprise architecture solutions, and business process modeling techniques. Besides, Edita has conducted numerous trainings and workshops in Europe and has given various presentations at international conferences. She is also an OMG certified UML systems modeling and business process management professional. Before Edita starts, let me remind you that today's presentation and demo will take about 50 minutes and the question answer session about 10. And if you have questions, you don't need to wait for the question answer session to ask them. You can do this during the entire webinar and Edita will answer them later on. All you need to do is type your questions in the questions area. However, due to limited time, some questions might be left unanswered. In such case, answers will be published later on the webinar's webpage. So Edita, are you ready to start?
Yes, thank you, Inga. Nomagic company, I guess you know, that is developing well-known solutions for modeling in different areas. And as product vendors, we are highly interested that modeling standards were well designed and brought value for customers. This is why our company is actively participating in standards development in OMG group. And we participate in different standards creation like UML, SysML, BPMN, UPDM, and of course UAF, Unified Architecture Framework. And during this session, we will talk about the new upcoming standard that is being developed by OMG. This standard is UAF or UPDM-free. We will discuss the purpose of the standard, why it was created, we'll see how the standard can be applied as well as in industry, as in military or government organizations. The second part of our demo will be a tool demonstration, and I will show you how to create enterprise architecture using our tool, Cameo Enterprise Architecture. So, when we talk about the enterprise, we can define an enterprise as any collection of organizations that has common set of goals. The issues appear when we want to analyze related systems, see their connections, communications, want to see them in the context of the whole organization. Here we can use the enterprise architecture. It can be used to model whole enterprise, single organization, department, or even project. Defining the enterprise architecture helps us understand the conception of the system. This is very useful for answering some questions about the system. Actually, when you define the enterprise architecture, you always need to make various decisions, like how to structure your model, what views you need to build, which artifacts you need to deliver, and in what sequence all of this should be done. Enterprise Architecture Framework helps us to deal with all of this. Enterprise Architecture Framework is a set of conventions, principles, and practices for the description of architectures that is established within a specific domain or application. And or community of stakeholders. So architecture frameworks helps us to decide how our enterprise architecture shall be described. Currently, In the market, we have a UPDM2 standard that is dedicated for enterprise architecture. UPDM is a unified profile for DODAF, MODAF, and MAF. It was developed by members of OMG with help from industry and government domain experts. UML allows us to describe the enterprise architecture and defines what elements are available for description. But UPDM itself is not an architectural framework. It is not methodology, it is not a process, just enterprise modeling language. UPDM does not provide a set of use of or viewpoints that need to be created. It does not have any recommendations what artifacts you need to create. So this is why UPDM is always used in combination with some architectural framework, and most often it is MODAF, NAF, and DODAF. Now in the market you can find a number of existing enterprise frameworks. Well known are defense architecture frameworks that are widely popular, like MODAF is a Ministry of Defense architecture framework, DODAF is Department of Defense architecture framework, NAF is NATO architecture framework. And there are some government frameworks, industry frameworks, like TOGAF, Zahman frameworks, they are also quite popular. So there is a need to align all these frameworks and allow easy exchange of information between organizations using different frameworks. Who usually is using architecture frameworks? Defense frameworks are used by DoD and its contractors on various MBCA and IT projects. These frameworks sometimes are used also outside of United States now. Industry and government has also a big need for architecture frameworks, especially large organizations like NASA, CACI, different research projects. We usually start from business process modeling, architectures for information systems, and some of them come up to model-based system engineering, MBCA, and specific frameworks usage. When we look to enterprise architecture framework from industry position, the first thing what is needed is framework demilitarization. Sometimes a broader scope is needed, like human views or system of systems definition. So why do we need UAF? The needs that I stated before were brought a need for a new framework. The new framework was asked to support a proliferation of existing military frameworks, had to provide ability to support other frameworks as well. There was a strong need to support industry and federal usage, as well as military frameworks. Also, some technical requirements were defined, like to support DMM, domain meta model, or provide standard profile usage for UML and SysML tools. In this slide, you can see excerpt from official requirements that were defined for the new standard. The standard is named UPDM3 or UAF, Unified Architecture Framework. Some of major mandatory requirements are to provide domain metamodel derived from MODEM and DM2, an architecture framework profile shall use SysML, profile must support BPMN2 and shall use SysML requirements, elements, and diagrams. Framework shall use SysML parametric elements and diagrams mapped to measurements. There shall be traceability matrices for supported frameworks. And also, there were some non-mandatory requirements like some profiles and vocabulary support, human systems integration, security viewpoint support, and so on. So we can see that there are two major artifacts created within UAF framework. This is the profile for modeling language. It is called UPDM3 or UAFP. The profile is like a language for enterprise architecture representation, and it is a replacement for UPDM2. Another artifact is UAF framework itself. It is defined as a grid and shows what view specifications are needed to create for one or another domain. Why the new framework is organized as grid? It is very hard to manage the views with so many contributing frameworks. It led to very complex mapping tables, unwieldy descriptions, and so on. The grid provides an abstraction layer, so it is possible to map many other frameworks onto the UAF. Grid commercializes the UAF whilst still supports warfighter needs. There is still the same underlying architectural data structures and view constructs that support DODAF, MODAF, NAF. There is still the same data model but different presentation layers. Grid can be used together with existing frameworks like DODAF, MODAF, NAF, and also can be used by industry or government. That was a requirement for UAF. The grid itself took the inspiration from NAV4 and Zachman architectural frameworks and has a grid form. So in this slide, you can see the UAF grid. The rows of the framework define domains, and the columns are model kinds that describe that domain. In the intersecting cells, we get view specifications. For example, we can see that UAF has defined metadata, strategic, operational, services, personnel resources, security, projects, standards, and actual resources domains. For them, we can define taxonomy, structure, connectivity, processes, states, interaction scenarios, information, parameters, constraints, roadmap, and traceability. Also, there are dictionary, summary and overview, and requirements defined. We have two new domains available in this framework. Personnel helps to deal with human systems integration, and security domain is dedicated for cybersecurity definition. Requirements definition is reused from SysML standard, and all the SysML requirements types and diagrams can be used for requirements definition in UAF. All architecture frameworks, framework domains fit together. We usually start from defining operational domain, operational scenarios, or how we expect our system to work and how it interacts with environment. And then finally, we provide multiple designs and solutions for each operational scenario. We can perform different trade-offs to pick the best alternative. So UAF standard provides a number of benefits. Standard goes beyond DODAF, MODAF, NAV, and can be used together with these frameworks, but still also can be used in industry and government. Actual resources are defined as instance models of the architecture that allow to perform dynamic simulation, execution, and computational analysis. Security domain included for information assurance. This domain is aligned to NIST and DoD. It is also related to an OMG threat risk modeling standard. Requirements can be defined and related to all parts of the architecture. Framework also allows mapping to MBCA approach based on SysML. The same pattern excuse me, the same pattern is applied across different domains. There are cross-cutting concerns defined that are common via all domains. These are information models and parameters for defining measurements. So we can see that UAF provides a standard framework for defining many different aspects of complex architectures. And now I will show you several slides with UAF framework views, and then we will move to the demo. So the samples in these slides are based on search and rescue operations. Search and rescue operations sample is provided together with UAF specification. And these models are created using NoMagic tool, Cameo Enterprise Architecture, or CEA. So in this slide, you can see the strategic viewpoint that is dedicated for defining capabilities. And this viewpoint defines the desired business outcome and the capabilities that are required to achieve it. You can see that strategic domain is green in the grid, and the view specification that we are describing in this diagram, strategic taxonomy, is highlighted in the grid. So strategic taxonomy view specification presents all the capabilities that are referenced throughout one or more architectures. In addition, it can be used as source document for development of high-level use cases and user requirements. Another diagram that I would like to show you is operational structure view. And operational structure view specification provides a logical perspective of this, of the architecture. Operational domain in grid is blue one, you can see it, and operational structure cell is highlighted in the grid. So operational structure view defines a mission, class of mission, scenario, and shows the main operational concepts and interesting or unique aspects of operations. With the help of operational structure diagram, you can describe interactions between the subject architecture and its environment, and between the architecture and external systems. Another thing that we can define in operational domain is operational processes and connectivity. Operational process is the diagram with the boxes, and operational processes view specification concerns at capturing activity-based behavior or flows. It describes the activities that are normally conducted in the course of achieving business goals that support a capability. The operational connectivity, the table below, this view specification summarizes logical exchanges of information between operational performers and logical activities that produces and consumes them. After we have defined operational domain, usually we come up to the resource domain. And resource domain is orange in the UAF grid. And in the slides, you can see resource structure and connectivity diagrams. Internal resource structure diagram shows how the system is constructed, and it also can show what signals are sent between inner system parts. And connectivity diagram captures interactions between resources, shows how these resources communicate to each other. Next diagram shows a personal domain that is white in UAF grid, and personal domain is a newly defined domain in UAF. It aims to clarify the role of human factors when creating architectures in order to facilitate both human factors integration and systems engineering. the personal structure diagram that you can see now usually consists at typical common structure definition and is used as basis for analysis. For example, evaluation of different alternatives, what-ifs, trade-offs on the actual resource configurations. Another domain is security domain. This domain is also new to UAF. UPDM 2 did not have any tools for defining securities, and now security domain is added and it supports cyber security and risk analysis modeling. It concerns at addressing security constraints and information assurance attributes that exists on exchanges between resources and operational performers. Okay. One of the model kinds in UAF grid is a roadmaps. We show domain relation to a timeline. For example, the project roadmap view specification concerns at product portfolio management, a planning capability delivery. It provides a timeline perspective on programs or projects. The strategic roadmap view specification represents the fulfillment of capability requirements and planned achievement of capability at different points in time or during specific periods of time. And roadmap is displayed as a separate column, as a model kind that can be applied for most of domains. Another model kind is traceability. Traceability is the last column in a grid, and it shows traceabilities between different domains, how domains are related to each other. Traceability usually is used for impact and coverage analysis, and this is why traceability model kind is added as separate column to a grid. Traceability can be direct and indirect. It can be represented in different ways, in specification dialogues of element, in matrices, in relations maps, and new traceability traceability rules can be created in the project and can be used for different purposes. Last, but not the least important, is model execution and parametrics. Here we can analyze parameters of elements that can be countable. Also, we can simulate the model to understand how our system will work. Once we have enterprise architecture, SysML, we can simulate DODA views and SysML diagrams and prepare conclusions about the status. So, it was several samples, and now I will move to the live demo and will show you how can we model enterprise architecture using the UAF framework. Okay. I am opening the new project, and you can see Chimera Enterprise Architecture Ops. Sorry, you cannot see the screen. Yes, you can see the screen now, and the new project is loading. Okay, and I will use this product, Chimera Enterprise Architecture, and will show you how to model enterprise architecture using UAF standard. So I will start from strategic viewpoint, strategy, and this viewpoint is used to identify the capabilities of my organization, project, or enterprise. I will start from creating a strategic taxonomy diagram. strategic taxonomy diagram and can create my capabilities in here. I can create capabilities using a toolbar buttons, but to save time, I have these capabilities in Excel, in a Microsoft Word file, and I can copy them and can paste into the diagram, and elements will be created automatically. I want to create capabilities. So I don't need to create everything manually, but I can use some automated tools. And we can see that we have a main capability, search and rescue, SAR, which has sub-capabilities like search, recovery, and assistance. So we can we have defined the requirements for our system, and this is the highest level of abstraction. Sometimes we can call them high-level requirements or main use cases or strategy. It depends on the terms that you are using. After I have defined my requirements, I can move to operational domain. And we'll go to the details of operations and operational scenarios. And now I know that I will need a taxonomy diagram to define what kind of operational performers I have. So I create operational taxonomy diagram. And now I will also copy operational performers to create them in my diagrams. Yep, just control paste, and I want to create operational performers. Yep, I have operational performers in here. Next step, what I would like to do, I want to say that person in distress is sending signal to a search node, and search node then communicates to a rescue node. Okay. And now I need to show what kind of information is sent between these operational performers. For that, I need to create operational information elements, and I will copy them from the Word document again and paste them into operational information package. So I just paste them and select that I want to create them as information elements. Here I have operational elements created, and now I can easily see that person in distress sends a distress signal to a search node. So I take distress signal and drag and drop it on the association to see that this signal is sent. Click finish, and distress signal is sent from person in distress to a search node. The same way I can drag and drop location and see that search node sends location to a rescue node and also sends medical condition to a rescue node. So here I have defined what kind of operational performers I have and how these performers communicate. And now I can create a short scenario using operational process diagram. For that, in operational processes package, I will create a new activity diagram. Create new diagram. It is operational process flow diagram, and we'll name it search activity. Okay, it is search activity, and now I would like to show what performers participate in this activity. So I drag my performers from browser, and I drag person in distress to a diagram swim lane is created, then I drag search node, and I add rescue node. Now I need to show how the process is performed, and we start from the initial node. Then person in distress sends signal to a search node. Send. Signal. Search node then receives signal. And sends medical conditions and location. Okay. And rescue node receives information. I will make a little bit more space, and we can show that we have a final node, activity final here, and my process is finished. We could draw a larger process, but for us that's okay. If we would look to operational taxonomy diagrams, we can see how our performers communicate to each other. Person in distress sends signal to search node. Search node sends signals to a rescue node. We can display and reuse the same information in our operational process flow diagram just by selecting the path and asking to show all the operational exchanges. And we can see what signals are sent between operational performers. In the model, we still do not have signal between between performer search node itself. And here we need to pass the distress signal. So I can take distress signal and drag and drop it on the path, and I can tell that search node sends signal to a search node. Finish. And the signal sending is displayed in the diagram. The next thing what I would like to see is in what operational activities participate performers that I have defined. I can get overview of my system by creating a dependency matrix. This tool is very useful for analyzing model via different aspects. So I create a new dependency matrix. Oops, sorry, not on the right place. It's in operational. Yeah. I can create a new dependency matrix. Operational. And I would like to see operational performers as row elements in the matrix. So I drag and drop operational performer from browser to the row element type. I would like to see operational activities as column element types. And I would like to see information from all the model. Dependency criteria, it shows how rows are connected to the columns, so I will select relation is capable to perform. is capable to perform, and OK. So we have a matrix that shows our model information, and we can see that person in distress is participating in send signal activity, rescue node is participating in receive information activity, and search node is participating in receive signal and send medical conditions activities. Okay. I have defined my capabilities, strategical level, and my operational level. Now I would like to connect these two abstraction levels, and I can connect them using different tools. At first, I will show you how can I create them, connect them in the diagram. So I go back to my strategic taxonomy diagram, and I drag all the performers into this diagram, like here, and the operational performer exhibits capability. There is a specific link type that says exhibits, and we can show that these performers exhibit search capability. Another way to show traceability, to define traceability between different abstraction levels, is to create a matrix. So I will create a strategic traceability matrix, go to the strategic domain and strategic traceability package. Here I can create a new diagram, strategic traceability diagram. And in this diagram, elements are collected automatically. You can change the filters, but elements are collected automatically. And I can see that my search capability is implemented by search activity. Is implemented by search activity. Now I can analyze the information that I have in the model. I can use the predefined relation maps to analyze these relations, and I will create for my capabilities, I will take the main capability, search and rescue, and will create a structural capability structural map. This is predefined map that shows the structure of the capability. It collects information via different domains if these elements are related. So we can see that our SAR capability is contained from assistance, recovery, and search subcapabilities, and search capability is exhibited by person in distress, rescue node, and search node. The different types of relations are marked in different colors, and you can see the legend at the top of the relation map. Now I will create one more relation map. I will create it for search capability, and I will create behavioral map. So here we can see that search capability is mapped by search activity, operational activity, and search activity is composed of smaller operational activities. Okay. Once we have traceability from one level to another, like from capabilities to operational viewpoint, we can track the coverage and calculate metrics for our project. Here we can see if all capabilities are covered, and also if we do not have unnecessary performance that are not related. Metrics can be customized and can use all the information that exists in the model. So we may track different aspects. So from the strategy package, I just go to the tools menu and create a new metric table. As we can have different type of metrics calculated, I will leave just one of them, operational related to operational performers, because we have defined only this aspect in our model. I click OK, and metrics table is created. What we can see in here, we have four capabilities in our model, and we can see that 25% of capabilities are covered by operational performers. Also, we can see how many operational performers we have and operational performers coverage. Now, I will go back to my relation map, and for recovery capability, I will create a new operational performer that is exhibiting this capability, and we'll call it station. Yeah. Now, if I have a better percent of capabilities covered now, and if I go to the strategic metrics table, I can right-click on the table and ask to calculate new metric. Metrics are recalculated, and now I can see that I still have four capabilities, but already 50% of capabilities are covered by operational performers. So my metrics are different, and you can track how your model is changing during the time. So what I have done by now is I have defined my operations, and now I can go into more details by defining the solutions. So I will create a couple of solutions for my operational scenario, and I can do that using my structural relation map. I go to this relation map, and for the search node, I can create a capability configurations. It will be search unit version 1, and press Ctrl Enter to add one more search unit version 2. I will create a couple of versions of capability configurations, and we will check and we will define that during one phase of project lifecycle, we will use version 1 of capability configuration, and then we will move to the second capability configuration. Now I move to the resources package, to the resources domain, and I will copy the resources that I will need for system definition, and I paste them into the resource structure package, paste as resource artifacts. Yeah, I have them in here. And I can define a resource structure in resource structure diagram. And now I will do that for just a second. I will find element, move them to the right place in browser. Yes. Yeah, so here I have my search unit 1 and search unit 2 capability configurations, and I will create a diagram, resource structure diagram, to define how the structure of this capability configuration should be created. So at first I need a yacht in here, but this yacht is in distress, and it will send distress beacon. Next thing, what I need compass SARSAT system to which signal will be sent, and I also need a search boat, which later will be replaced by helicopter. Now I will create a resource port in here. Resource ports in here, all the resource ports that I need to connect these elements. Here and here. And I can connect these resource ports using connector relation. If we were modeling the full system, the resource ports should have type resource interface, but as we are lack of time during this demo, we don't have enough time, I will not create the type for the ports. So we have our system defined, and now I would like to show that what kind of signals are sent from one system part to another. I already have some data elements created in my model, so I drag and drop it to create the signals. So this yacht sends a signal to compass SARSAT system, and compass SARSAT system sends signal to a search boat and also sends the coordination messages. Here. I have defined the detailed system structure, and now I would like to see the higher level of abstraction of this diagram, so I will create a resource taxonomy diagram. And I can show my elements in here. I can show yacht. I can show compass SARSAT system. And I can show a search boat. Yep, I can draw relations between them. And as I have already defined what kind of signals are sent between these resource artifacts, I can display this information in my model. Here I want to show the signal, here the coordination, and signal is being sent. So I don't need to recreate information, I just display the information that I have created before. So now I would like to add model the second version of my resource configuration. So I can add yacht and inherit it, draw inheritance relationship from the search boat. Now, yacht will have all the same features that search boat has, but may... It shouldn't have been a yacht. It should have been a helicopter. Yeah, search boat will be replaced by helicopter. And it will add additional functionality. So now I can create a diagram for capability configuration 2 to define that now I have, again, I have yacht that is in distress. It has distress beacon inside. We have compass SARSAT system, and we have a helicopter now already. Now, in order not to create recreate ports, I can reuse already existing ports that I created in diagram before. So I can click button to show all the ports. I can create connections that I need now, resource connectors. And you can see that helicopter already has the same ports as yacht had. I did not create them in a model, but these ports were inherited. And we need coordination on one. We need signal on other relation. And here we also pass signal. Here we have it. Now I need to analyze that if I want to change a search boat by helicopter, I need to analyze the impact of this change. I need to know what other parts of my system will be affected. So I create an impact analysis map on for search boat. I take search boat and create a diagram. It is resource, oops, not here, in a diagram for search unit 1. Oops, sorry, I just open that diagram. And for a search boat, I can create diagram, resource impact analysis map. And all the elements that are related to a search boat are collected into this diagram, and you can see that different criteria are analyzed. What are inputs, outputs, resource exchanges, context, and other different relationships. So you know that if you want to change search boat by another element, you should look at these elements that are related to your system. Okay, now I would like to define some safety aspects for my system, and I will move to the security viewpoint. Actually, this is the last point of my demo, and I go to the SARP map, and for the search node, I want to define one more capability configuration. I can create it directly in the diagram, and it will be cyber defense. Yeah. And I select it in containment tree, cyber defense. I move it to the security structure package. And now here I can create a security structure diagram. And I can show that I have cyber defense in my system, which part has inner part as cyber defense software, cyber defense software. And we can define that it has some security enclaves like sec enclave 1. In this security viewpoint, you can define inner structure then for security enclaves. You can define security parameters, measurements, and show what signals are sent from one resource to another to ensure the security. And now if I go back to my security diagram, I can see that under security cyber defense node, I already have cyber defense software and enclave. I also have my resources displayed in this diagram, so I can see the whole structure of my system. Okay, so we have seen all the most of views of our operational performer. And it's now time for questions and answers if there is left some time. Okay.
Thank you, Dita. And yes, now is the question time. So please give us a few minutes while editor reads the questions and prepares for answers. We'll be right back. So the first question is, it's not a question actually, but we'd like to comment it. I'm hoping you mentioned that it was Canada's Department of National Defense, Rob Hudson and Dr. Randy Fritt that presented the original concept for UAF and even named it the Universal Architecture Framework.
Okay, thank you, Randy, for comment. I didn't mention that, but I wanted to everyone know that. And also, I wanted to mention that security domain concept also came from Canada's Department of Defense. Okay?
The next question is the UAF profile still a draft and has No Magic implemented the full standard?
Yes. UAF specification is not released publicly yet. I have a slide on here. Just trying to go back. Yeah. Currently, UAF standard is released as beta version, and it can be downloaded from OMG site. And finalization task forces are now being performed on OMG, and specification is expected to be final in June 2017. Also, I would like to mention that UAF specification consists of four major parts. It is UAFP or UPDM-free. It is the modeling language defines the main elements. Then it is UAF, domain metamodel and architecture framework itself, the grid. And also there are leading documents like traceability to donor frameworks and metamodels to show how to map grid to MODAF, DODAF frameworks. And there is a leading sample problem document that is based on search and rescue sample. Okay.
And the next question, is the impact map part of the UAF or a nice feature of Camille?
Actually, impact map is the feature of Camille enterprise architecture. It's just a tool that helps to understand our system structure better.
My question, are many organizations already using UAF?
UAF is still upcoming standard and there is no official version yet, but we already have quite many customers that are using this framework. But we still also have many organizations that use UPDM2 standard with other frameworks to model enterprise architectures. But we are still getting more and more customers who are using UAF.
We have more questions here, and more questions are still coming, but since we're running out of time, we'll publish the rest of the answers on the webinar's webpage. Thank you all for participating, and we hope to see you again in upcoming webinars. Please don't hesitate to contact us if there is anything else you'd like to ask. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Thank you for attention.